Just a couple of more minutes. We'll get started. Getting close. I'm just trying to, I think I've found Gordon, but I have two people on the phone, so I'm trying to figure out who's who.
That's me.
Good morning, everyone. Oh, great. We've got Gordon. We'll talk with Gordon in just a moment. Welcome to the Land and Resources and Economic Forum. It's day three. We're going to have teachings of the Wampum Belt, 1764 Wampum Belt, in just a few minutes. But to get things started, I'd like to call on Evelyn McLeod to get us started this morning, and we'll get our morning going. Evelyn?
Anen Vojo. Gok Miss Evelyn Dish Nikazman Bissing Donchpa, Yuma and Dayan, Neshi and Odem. Yipskayan. Gwynnes Cewyn. Jamod Stong. Ys byn wy a eong. Bojo mys rhwm sag o'ch mys ag nhw yn dawg na'n anig. Mae'r yna cew obnwng yn jamod sy'n cyn ag ego byw o seog. Ysgygis gyd. Nid y semong i wyb gydno. Wedyn dim oed stong, yn nhw'n gwydyng mewn gysg o chynog na gewyn. Gyd dwi'n nhw'n gwmeog. Wewen ag yn dynib mwysau. Wewen yn dig nhw'n deang. Wewen yn dig nhw'n adwy dib modus. Nan dynib mwysau, wewen yn mwyn. Yn nod sy'n Mikos. What a gay show, no matter gay, keep get no semo. What a gook me suck me shum suck no and ognanonic. Aya what na care. Gavin Wanjibe, we do cause what? My geekdom. What a gnay na care, go be on, Ningish monk. Mi gawr y gwg mysag, mi siomsag, nhw yn dawg nyn o'n y gawr yn o'r yn gio wad. Dwi dwi'n cos wad. Mae'r y gys am o'n gyn i'r cydno, wedi nacau. Mae'r y gyn nacau gi wednw. Mi gawr y nacau. Mi siomsag, gwg mysag, nhw yn dawg nyn o'n y. Yn ag o'n gytim na'n y gym o'r gio wad. Gawr yn o'n dwi dwi'n cos wad. Mae nhw'n gwmen o'ch nygyng. At Botch Godic. Watch. Mina. Amigwatch where on and get tuck me queer. Can I get go where me is young? And there's seven. Nibby. Me Jim. Nowhere see yuck. Mina, it's a P10 dog walk. I'm sticky. Ishnabe. Not so when they opted to go there. Minnow, and just old cowboy young, can I mom way, kish cowboy egg. Just on day young. Away when I not so engineer, national bank general sort of what, Miigwech.
Miigwech, Evelyn. Thank you so much. The Gordon is joining us as well, Elder Gordon. It's great to have you back. I would like to hand it over to you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Hello.
Yes, we can hear you.
It's a very nice morning today. Birds are singing. Cows are mooing. Fish are jumping. And we all got up this morning. Right, Scott?
Yes.
Me Monday anyway. This is our language that the Creator gave us. We are all one nation of people. Devinjigit, Kisan Nishnabe King, Minidoadzivinigibitagunagade. The Creator placed humankind on Mother Earth. Along with that, there was a gift that was given that was spirituality. There was four gifts that was given to humankind to look after. And they are fire, water, land, and air. They been to give me on which to end dog. Why not the daughter of Nishna Ben Mopi almost said to get to come along. The Creator also gave Nishnabe the foundations, the guiding principles to guide them as we walk on Mother Earth. Those laws are Zagedwin, Debuwin. Love, truth, respect, wisdom, humility, honesty, and bravery. This next paragraph is so, so important. They eventually get giving on the way we not doing. The Creator gave us sovereignty. Sovereignty to govern ourselves. Me just gonna watch one the game in eye. They want the monk. I wait the nungo. She now goes snob. We've not in the monk. Copies way book. Copies his web zing. May go nungo. I gave me nice web book. Remember the game in eye. They will be chukush way out to yabe. Cut up no jing in onic. And Kubjagasak. What is your book, Gyab? We have to understand, our past in order for us to understand where we are going to be going. We have to understand what's happening now. And more importantly, the future of the Anishinaabeg Nation. We have to understand those prophecies, those seven prophecies that was given to us many, many years ago when the cycle of life first started. One of the things that I fully understand was the union that was created in the third fire. The union between the sun and the moon. There was instructions that was given to our grandfather, the sun. Those instructions were to bring light and understanding to this new world. Our grandfather was to shine upon the creation of life. He was doing that then, and he is still doing that today. When the third fire was lit, there was also a bond between our grandmother and the Creator. The Creator used those four gifts that I mentioned, fire, water, land, and air. In combination of those things, He created Mother Earth and Grandmother Moon. She will shine upon you when the sun goes down. We will give thanks to her to give light in the darkness, to look after the environment that we live in, controlling the environment. Without Grandmother Moon, we will not survive. We will not survive with our grandfather also. So that's the union that was created in the third fire of creation and the seven prophecies of the Anishinaabeg Nation. They are so, so important. And if we seem to not observe those things or give thanks to those things every day, we will not survive. We will be confused. We will be walking in the dark, in the mist, forever. So that's one of the reasons why we give thanks. I thank everyone so much for us to be able to get together like this, this new way of communication. But you know what we need to do? We need to be around a fire. Maybe it's the third fire of creation. Let's go outside today and let's go outside tonight and give thanks to those things that give life to us every day. You get to meet an Ivanik. There's so much to say. Thank you for listening.
Miigwech, Gordon. Well, we're going to get started this morning. Evelyn got us started with a prayer. Gordon, I could just sit and listen to all day. So Miigwech. And just a bit of the format today. We're going to learn teachings of the 1764 Wampum Belt. We're then going to move to environmental protection, regulatory, and capacity gap with some of the technicians from around the area. And then we're going to move to Anishinaabeg Nation Caucus. And we encourage you to stay with us, attend, as we try to do this virtually for the first time that I'm aware of. And one of the things we'll be doing is we won't be streaming it on YouTube. And the only recording of the caucus that will be happening is just for the Land and Resources Forum. So that's what that will be used for as we record it. So I'd like to call on Alan Corbier. Alan, I know you're with us to get us started on teachings of the 1764 Wampum Belt. I'm going to ask to unmute you.
Honey. Ah. Nin Stojik, Mampim Chiging Don Jaba, Chinendam Dash Gibijaya Mampi, Awasmo Sabing. I'm glad you asked me to come here. Minwa Dash Nui Ke Miigwechwe Aka Getsijik, Nishnabe Majik, Evelyn Minwa Meshike, Gimishomena, our uncle. Shiken for opening it up and giving us a bit of the teachings that he carries. That's one of the things that I miss when the union usually asks me to come out to things in the past. Then there would be a sunrise Thanksgiving, and I'd usually like going there to listen to and participate, but to listen to Gord open it up and chant the prayers. Anyway, so I'm glad to be asked to speak about this, and I'll try and go fast. There's too much to try and talk about, and I tried to squeeze this down a bit more, and I tried to change it up too. And if anybody's listening here that actually wants to see more of this, actually just go on to YouTube, and a couple of my talks are on there about this as well. And non godinong ginapadom, but you can forgive those. A bit of sometimes napajigijwe, sometimes I'll make a mistake speaking in our language, but otherwise you can actually listen to that online. I'm trying to share the screen here, but I can't.
That was my fault, Alan. You should be able to do it now.
Okay. So this is one of the things I hope that I really emphasize in this short time is not only the wampum belt, but also the medal, and how that medal is a symbol of the treaty alliance and a mnemonic device of that treaty alliance. This particular medal was given at Niagara in 1764, and reportedly, based on the archives, that I think it was 40, there were 40 of them made at that time. And then this medal was restruck again in 1766, and another round of them were given out. But why this is important is that device actually refers to the tree of life, and you see that tree there, and then also sitting on a mat together and smoking a pipe. And then also the clasp of the medal is actually what they call a calumet pipe. Pwagen, Kchupwagen, and then you see that eagle wing on there, and they would tie an eagle, these long pipes would have the tails of an eagle feather suspended on it, and that's what they would use when they were longer than the pipes we use now. So this is of course called a Covenant Chain Wampum Belt, and it's a 1764. but it actually was formed earlier with the Mohawks and the Dutch, and then it through successive agreements, it was first a rope of friendship, then an iron chain of friendship, then it became a silver covenant chain of friendship. And then the bottom one is what we call the 24 Nations Wampum Belt, but also the promise of eternal gifts. So that boat there on the right of that wampum belt at the bottom is actually supposed to be full of gifts for the Anishinaabeg that the British promised to deliver us every year as long as the sun shone, the grass grew, and the rivers flowed. This belt is actually, I've heard a lot of people talk about the belt, and then they'll talk about it as a nation-to-nation relationship, which it actually is, and I don't dispute that, but it's actually even more than that. It actually does represent from our perspective, our independence, or the Binwewazewin, as Sheikh Khan had said, and that also that we are allies to the crown, not the subjects, and that we call this allies friendship. We call it Minowichkendewin. Minowichkendewin or Minowendewin is what we call this, and that we made each other brothers. But we're also, sometimes they say we became brothers, other times we say we became friends. And then it also, throughout these discussions at these treaty councils, they actually talked about this belt, and they actually talked about it as our land ownership, that the British would recognize our land ownership with this belt. And that's one of the things that we want. I really hope that we actually look at this belt and acknowledge it as what lawyers call Aboriginal title. And also it represents our protection, that the British were to protect us against themselves, which of course is a hard thing for anybody to do. And as we know, the British didn't do a very good job of that. And then it also is to be what we call support, and what our ancestors called warmth. And warmth meant that clothing. But also, it's of course a metaphor about the sun, and the British ended up taking their symbolism is that they wear red, and that wearing red, they said that they imitate the sun, and that whenever we saw them wearing red, we were to be reminded that these promises were still in effect, and that also when you see the sun rising, it was supposed to represent, it was supposed to evoke the king or the queen. And that when that sun rises red, it's supposed to remind us that these promises are still in effect, that they recognize our sovereignty, our independence, our friendship. They recognize that we are the owners of this land, and that they said they're going to promise to protect us against their settlers, or what they called squatters. And then also that they were going to support us and give us warmth for living on our land. And that warmth is the blankets. It is the cloth that they gave us to make shirts and skirts and leggings. And then also after we fought with them alongside them in different wars, it was actually represented payment and service for past services. But later on, the chiefs used this to talk about their hunting and fishing and timber rights. So I listened in yesterday a couple of times, and with a lot of the questions are talking about coming onto the land and looking at how to make that a good relation, building relationships. And that's what this belt is about, is actually that we call it our foundational belt of a relationship with the British. And so usually we should actually start at the near the beginning with this belt, and remind ourselves what this belt means to the chiefs and to our fellow Anishinaabeg, Nij Anishinaabeg, that we need to understand this more. The other thing that I hope to really emphasize in this bit of time is that we gotta change the discourse, how we talk about this. So we continually talk about this in English, for one. And like we heard Evelyn and Mishika use our language, and we're consistently and using English, but not only that, we end up using legalese. And each time we do that, we remove ourselves from our understanding in a sense that, but if we actually pull these words back and we start to use them, use our language and use our the concepts that are in there, then we're going to increase our understanding more. And then when we start to abide by that more, then we'll have a more robust understanding of the teachings that Mishika is giving to us, and then what's also encoded in this wampum belt and these talks here. So one of the things that I also want to emphasize that there was a grand council before there was a Union of Ontario Indians, before it became called the Anishinaabeg Nation. And this grand council would meet numerous times, and they started documenting their meetings, their gatherings. And I took this from one of their meetings that was held in 1879 up at Garden River. And then there was also one held in Garden River again in 1869, and then it moved to Little Current in 1870. And then they also published another another series in 1881, and they had that Grand Council at Neosh-Neosh-Inagaming, Cape Croker. So we have this history of our leaders meeting and deliberating upon these issues that they confronted, and the number of different times they wrote about these belts. So this is one in 1879, and they wanted to take a petition, and they wanted to go to England to explain this treaty. And they put in a petition. They said they were told by their great father, the king, that he would not always live to look after them. And remember, that's protection there. And now we call that fiduciary responsibility. And their rights, that after his decease, efforts might be made by evil disposed persons to deprive them of their presence. And that's the warmth that I was talking about. And if they were ever so unfortunate as to lose them, all they would have to do would be to present the treaty and the medal, which I give to them, to my successor in the throne of England, and both the covenant and the promise would be speedily and faithfully carried out and the presence restored to them. So here the other thing is, when we look at the word covenant and promise, to Anishinaabe words, we would say Wawin Damage, somebody is promising something. And when I was talking to a late elder here in Chiging, he had brought up a treaty, and the word he used for treaty was and then now I see others say which is kind of the same, in a sense the same word. But we don't really say covenant per se. And so that's the thing, is we're trying to learn. I'm hoping that we learn the words that our ancestors used to describe this relationship. So the medal, the chiefs in this petition actually referred to that medal and the treaty. And when we went to court in 2017, the Canadian government and their expert witnesses insisted that the wampum belt and the Treaty of Niagara wasn't a treaty. That was their position, as well as the Ontario government. And so we have to really be mindful that their definition of a treaty is a cession with a paper document that is countersigned. So they're looking, because the Treaty of Niagara doesn't actually have a piece of paper where all the different chiefs went and put their X or their dotem, they say there is no such treaty. And then also in Sir William Johnson's papers, where they recorded this treaty, it actually says the Congress at Niagara. So they end up saying it's not a treaty. This is what the government of Ontario and Canada say. It's not a treaty, it's a Congress. But for us, our ancestors, Ogima Binanak, our ancestral chiefs, they're the ones that refer to this as a treaty, and they're referring to that wampum belt in this particular case. This was a document written in Mampi Chiging, in here in Chiging, and back then Gijin Kade Gaba Manda Shkunagan Chigued Nong. Long time ago, this place here, Chiging, where I'm from, was actually called Mchigued Nong, the place in the bluff foot in the shape of the spear. That's and it's a story about our great uncle Nanabojo dropping his spearhead at what is now called Cup and Saucer, but that's Mchigued Nong. Anyway, this is the letter they wrote in Anishinaabem when all the chiefs of Manitoulin, the majority of the chiefs of Manitoulin, and they gathered here at Chigued Nong to have this meeting. And this is what they had said: Giaba Nigit Kandan, Gajiga no Nadwaba, Nigit Zimak, a Pijit Wakajio Nuadwa, Awe Migazian, Nui Kanajwa Maba, Kikachigami Mawang, Wabimadabit, Ogana de Bendan, Gadabanoji, Madakimaway, Dewayanak, Agi Gano Nadwaba, Nigit Zimak. So it says there that I still know how you spoke to my ancestors. And here, Nigitzimak, we now say it means parents, but in this case, it meant the ancestors. When you asked them, you invited them to go to war, and you said, "I will chase away anybody who comes to your great lake, and your children will own that land there." This is what you said to my ancestors at Niagara. And of course, it doesn't say Niagara in English, or what I guess the English rendition of the Mohawk word of Niagara. But here, Wayanak is the word for Niagara, Anishinaabemowin, and it means the basin. And you know, at the bottom of each every waterfall, the water gouges out a basin there. And that's what this word means, Wayanak. Wede Wenjamok set Gizis in Nabian Kagawab ma Gizis jibmisquap kagojing Misa Ejinago Kamiskokanyea Nagesh Biming dash gibe egojing ao Gizis a pit apache wasakoza Misa ga Misa gi Ejinago the nick at the Benoji mobimadzwin Meanwhile dash notch spimming gibe egojing bebakanang Dajinagodon waskunen Misa ge ejinago de nika de banoji mo bemadzuin. Misa you ga ejin keen jagana shigoyin. So all of that he says there is look about in the sky for the means of your well-being. You will see a sun rising red in where the sun rises. And that red color is what I imitate in what I wear, this red coat. And then he says, as that sun gets up higher, it'll be brilliant. It'll shine all over, touching everywhere. And he says, and then as that sun even gets even more higher, flowers will appear. And that is the image of the life of your children. And that's the title of this slide. Misa ge jenagwa denik gadabinoji mo bimadzuin. That is the image of the life of your children, meaning that's, if you take this wampum belt, this silver covenant chain at Niagara, that is what was promised to us, was a life of warmth, meaning the sun, and then the flowers, of course, being prosperity, and also that they would protect us. So this, to me, this document here that is written in 1862 in Chigued Nong is our... I've heard other people talk about the Royal Proclamation as the Magna Carta of Indian rights in Canada. But to me, this is our what we would call our foundational agreement, our Magna Carta, if you want to use those words. So here, this is Sir William Johnson, who actually was the one who was the arbiter of that treaty. And here, this is the thing is when we talk about treaty clauses or mutual engagements. And here's where, again, we get into English, the use of English and how it's be different. So it says, you've been here several days, during which time we have frequently met to renew and strengthen our engagements. And you have made so many promises of your friendship and attachment to the English that there now only remains for us to exchange the great belt of the covenant chain, that we may not forget our mutual engagements. So again, now when we look at any treaties or any funding agreements or any kind of arrangements with the government, it's usually not so liberally or loosely worded. It's actually very legalese and technically written to kind of diminish our sovereignty. This is a painting. Of course, it wasn't done at the time. This painting was actually done maybe 100 years after the actual gathering, or 50 to 100 years. I forget the actual one. But it is of Johnson Hall, of his manor, where Sir William Johnson lived. And it's on the south shore of Lake Ontario. But you get an idea there. You have the Anishinaabeg Gyuta de Bewok. And in the middle of that gathering is that fire, and that's what our uncle Mshikin talked about at the beginning, to actually go out and offer that tobacco to that fire, and then that mbapteo shkude, then that smoke that takes that prayer of thanksgiving up to the Creator. And then also this disseminates it all around, as we say, Gyutai Yaat, Gdo Demonanik, Minwa Atazokanik, that all around us are these our clans, as well as those Atzokan, those spirits that we rely upon. And of course, this time now, we say Nba Wakunda Atzokanik, that they're sleeping, so now we can tell those stories. But here, this is the importance of that gathering around the fire and putting our tobacco in there, that this was actually part of why we call this wampum belt sacred, and that it was done under the eyes of the sun, and that this is a sacred obligation that we entered into with the British, and that we say and we maintain on our end that we actually kept that up. But the fact that in and around 1854, 90 years after they promised that, they actually broke their promise and they discontinued delivering those presents. So for us, sometimes people, myself included, I actually have to see the proof that we were there. So here, this is they didn't keep a total list, attendance list, but they did write down a number of the names that of the chiefs that were there. And from June 11th to the 13th, 1764, these Odawas, Ojibwe, Kanistano, Cree, Nipissings met with Sir William. And then that's the Ojibwe chiefs were Shawanagabo, standing to the south, Kageose, Zawangabi, Gyutasin, Wabagekek. And then the Odawa chiefs, Bindanwan, that's a quiver, Kashkoke, Tekamas, and I think that's actually a Tekamasimo, which is an older name, meaning lightning goes across the sky instead of straight up and down, Ochingwas, Bemasat, and I don't think that's Bemasat, Bemset, Jawanaswe, I think that would be Jawamase, but I think it would be Jawanase, and then Chibash Kizagan. And then also Giyokoshkam, Egomene, and the Swakwat also arrived. But we have Mississaugi chiefs that were there, one especially Wabkamagat, that from the Toronto area. So here, this was again on July 17th. Here's where he actually talks about the land. And this is Sir William Johnson telling all the gathered people there, brethren, we reduced all of Canada and of consequence became possessed of all the outposts which the French governor granted us by the capitulation. Although we were numerous and able, we did not attempt anything against you. They often sent armies against you, meaning the French, killed many of your people, and meditated a design of possessing themselves of your country. We never attempted the one nor intended the other. So here, he back then, of course, he's doing his own propaganda by saying the French tried to kill the Anishinaabeg, when actually that's who their allies were. What he says here importantly is that they had designs of possessing themselves of your country. We never attempted that nor intended it. So he's basically saying, we didn't want to cheat you out of your land. So he said that in council and he recorded it. And he says again, brothers of the Western nations, I desire you will take fast hold of the same, meaning the belt, and never let it slip, to which end I desire that after you have shown this belt to all nations, you will fix one end of it with the Chippewas at St. Mary's, whilst the other end remains at my house. Anyway, the Ojibwe chief, Gi Nani Bwe Ogema, Deje Ogema Balk Ting, the chief of Sault Ste. Marie then stood up. They didn't write down his name, but he ended up saying that this belt should actually be kept at Michilimackinac by the Odawa. And then that's how the Odawa were the ones that ended up being the caretakers of this belt on behalf of the Western Confederacy. And there's 12 nations that were to be represented in that actual agreement. And then others came and participated subsequent to the Treaty of Niagara and tied their hands in friendship with the British at that time. But note that at the end of that, this was a month-long meeting for the month of July. And then in August, medals were given, July 31st and August 1st, some medals were given to the chiefs. And they also gave certificates. So again, you see on this here, here's that tree of life that he talks about and that he set there. And then also this fire that they ignited. And then you see the pipe down here on the ground. And if any of you have been involved in ceremonies, and you'll see sometimes they'll put that pipe on a mat on the ground by the smudge. And then for when they're gonna light it up and everyone pass it around and smoke. So he gave the medals to them and he says, brother, we have thought of you, what you have said and greatly approve of the same. We are determined to follow your advice for the good of our people and we shall never swerve from our engagements, but look at the medals you have given us every morning. And when they're talking about every morning, they mean every morning, but also every spring. That's what they're talking about. And they're talking about that when they meet in the springtime, they're actually going to renew this treaty. The other thing that I wanted to mention is a lot of times the way the British enter into treaties is that it's once it's entered and signed, then it's done. It's a done deal. And that's the way they look at it. And that's their saying, it's a done deal. But to Anishinaabeg, when they give wampum, it's actually, that's the beginning of the relationship. And the beginning of the relationship means that you end up meeting every year to renew it and to check in on each other to show that relationship is still strong. And then that's why they adopted that silver covenant chain as a metaphor, that if anything were to tarnish it, they actually would get together to polish the chain, they would say. We don't want tarnish, so we'll meet right away. If any blood is shed on it, it may rust the chain. So they say that they got to wipe that and polish that chain of friendship. And that's a metaphor for maintaining harmonious relations. And of course, this was a way of actually making peace. And what they would, there was a bigger ceremony called the condolence ceremony and also covering the dead. But we won't get into that right now. But the main thing is that every year or annually or semi-annually, enough times they would get together to actually polish this chain. And that's the purpose of that council fire and the delivery of those gifts. So here are some of the medals that were given. And you see that King George's visage is on the one side, and then on the, his coat of arms is on the other. And these were the reminders that they said, that the chiefs had said in the previous slide that they would look to. And but look at the medals you have given us every morning. And so again, remember that I was saying that the medal actually refers to the mutual engagements, and that that's how the mnemonic device that was used by the chiefs to actually remember those promises. So here the council fire is where they would do these, do the business and conduct the renewal of the treaty, as well as settle any disputes. And now, we, of course, we call that alternative dispute resolution, but back then they would call it polishing the chain. So from 1764 to 1798, the council fire was at Michilimackinac, and that's where the belt was kept. And then they would deliver presents to the Anishinaabek, as well as the Ojibwe, Odawa, Potawatomi, Menominee, Sauk, Fox, Ho-Chunk, which was more commonly known as the Winnebago, and the Sioux people. So that those were the ones that were have been documented as visiting Michilimackinac, as well as St. Joseph's Island. So 1798, the Americans end up getting Michilimackinac is determined to be in American territory. And so that's why the council fire is changed to St. Joseph's Island. So for 14 years, it's the distribution of presents and the meeting of council is at St. Joseph's Island. What happens, and then it's the council fire is moved back to Michilimackinac. And then after the end of the War of 1812, because the Americans burnt St. Joseph, the fort at St. Joseph, so they established a council fire at Drummond Island, Potagonising, it's called in Anishinaabe. And then again in 1828, the British were told to vacate that because the Drummond Island became American property. Then the council fire was actually eventually ignited and maintained at Manitowining on Manitoulin Island here. And the presents that were given were distributed there from 1836 to 1854. And it was the people that were there were the Odawa, Ojibwe, Potawatomi, and Menominee. And by this time you could actually include Nipissing, but by this time they stopped in referring in the official record to people from Nipissing as Nipissing Anishinaabek. So they would just call them by this time Ojibwe. But it would include the Nipissing and Mississaugi. Here's a list of the presents that were given. But what I want to highlight here is here, they gave us tobacco. And to us, of course, we call that our sacred medicine or our first medicine and our means of communicating and expressing thanks to all of creation, as well as our ancestors, and as well as expressing our hopes for future generations. But also note that they gave us ball, gunpowder, and shot. So they are actually outfitting us with what some would say are Aboriginal rights, and others would say treaty rights to hunt here. And they gave us, of course, gunpowder, butcher knives, fire steels. But here's the warm part, all these different types of cloth they gave us and blankets. But it isn't just to give us warmth, but it was also giving us the means to enact our livelihood. And a number of our treaties actually state that we wanted to keep our hunting and fishing and to derive our living from that. So they were actually abiding by that at one point. The other one that I wanted to show and highlight here is also part of this Treaty of Niagara, and that what was put in that ship were 300 fishing hooks, 3 flags, 12 cod lines, and a net thread. So they actually gave us nets as well for our fishing, and fishing hooks and lines as well. So they're giving us the means to hunt and fish. And to me, that means that they're for those 90 years and beyond, they're actually saying that we do have the Aboriginal right to hunt and fish, and that they recognize that, and they're giving that to us. And so when they discontinued it, they're actually breaking the treaty, but we still maintain it. And it's and even though when they wrote, it was written in some of the treaties, especially Robinson-Huron ones, that actually we maintain the right to hunt and fish in the ceded territory. But this is actually all the territories that were ceded or entered into in treaty. Whoever participated in this Treaty of Niagara should actually, I would think, but I'm not a lawyer, that they still would have this right to hunt and fish. So again, I just wanted to reiterate that this actual wampum belt and this medal, the Treaty of Niagara, the Covenant Chain, actually refers to our independence or our sovereignty, that we were allies and friends, not subjects, and then that it refers to our being the land owners of this, and also that it's a support and warmth to us, that they were to give us that these blankets and cloth to keep warm. And then it is also payment for services during wartime. But it also, I hope I showed you that it also represents our hunting and fishing rights as well as our timber rights. So here, this in 1818, the Odawa chief Tokeda and his descendants live in Jishiguaning on Manitoulin Island. But he was the speaker at this meeting, at this council fire in Drummond Island. And they just brought down these three belts, and for kind of a mystery is he didn't bring out the 24 Nations belt, or wasn't recorded. Anyway, Jingwa Kons also, I want to just stress again, when I started delivering these kind of presentations in 2001, 2002, a lot of people would come up to me and say, "What are you talking about with a wampum belt? That's not us. That's a Mohawk thing. That's what Mohawks do, not Anishinaabeg." Now it's almost 20 years later. Now nobody says that. So they accepted now that we did use wampum, that Anishinaabeg people used wampum. And one of our great chiefs, Jigwakons from Gitagan Zibing, is documented as using that. And this is one of my favorite quotes, that at St. Joseph's Island, he says, holding a few strings of wampum in his hand, he said, "Father, the great master of life, gave us," meaning Anishinaabeg, "pipes and wampum for the purpose of conveying our ideas from man to man. I return thanks to the great spirit that made me and to my great father, the king who supports me. What he promised to our forefathers, he continues to perform. He is charitable to his red children." So here again, he started running into a bit of trouble with Americans especially, but also anybody, non-native people coming onto his land. And he wrote a number of different, he dictated a number of petitions. And then this is one from May 1835. Says, "Father, those houses you see all along the beach and the dwellers therein were never allowed by me or by my fathers to have built or to clear the little land they have. My father, our place is becoming like a meadow, for they have destroyed all the good timber about the place. I held a council with them last fall, telling them that they must pay attention to what I say, but they do not, and they will not pay attention." So he's again, he explains later that he says, "My young men want to take more drastic measures, and I've been accused of being a coward because I want to use peaceful measures to settle this dispute instead of forcibly kicking them out." And it should be noted that prior to the signing of the 1850 Robinson-Huron Treaty, he ended up, Jigwakons and his son-in-law, Nambadeyagujing, and others took a cannon up to Micah Bay mine and forcibly took over that mine. Anyway, this again is done at the council fire. He expressed these sentiments at the council fire when they were talking about their relations with that wampum belt as well. So here, this is Jean-Baptiste Siganac. And he was a keeper of that wampum belt, but he was also an interpreter of the Indian Department. And he also fought during the War of 1812. But he ended up, Sir Francis Bondhead, who was the lieutenant governor at the time, came up to Manitoulin and was actually there to actually tell the gathered Anishinaabeg that they were going to discontinue the presence. So when once Siganok heard that, he ended up bringing out the belts, and then he recited the belts to Bondhead, and then Bondhead decided, well, let's make a treaty. So that's when he decided that they would make a treaty, the Mantuani Treaty of 1836. But here's a snippet of, but this is actually in 1851, Siganok, somebody wrote down a Siganok's oral tradition. My children, I clothe your land. You see that wampum before me, the body of my words. In this, the spirit of my words shall remain. It shall never be removed. The Indians being my adopted children, their life shall never sink in poverty. So then at 1836, after Siganok recited that belt, Bondhead had Thomas Gummersall Anderson write out a treaty, and it's in his handwriting, and it says, 70 snow seasons have now passed away since we met in council at the Crooked Place, Niagara, at which time and place your great father, the king, and the Indians of North America tied their hands together by the wampum of friendship. So here, this is, as far as I know, this is the only treaty that I've read that actually refers to the Treaty of Niagara and shows that the chiefs actually saw their treaties as a succession to and building upon that foundation, not abrogating or derogating or replacing or supplanting, that it was actually in addition to that. And a lot of times they would say, I make it stronger. I make that one, that belt you got from Sir William Johnson, I know you still have it. And by delivering this belt, the British would say, I make it stronger. So that's what we have to keep in mind, is this foundational agreement. And I like how he said it, has said this, is I clothe your land. And again, bearing in mind back to the cloth and the treaties that were that they had delivered every year, meaning they clothed the land, but they also clothed us, and that we are one part of that land. And then also that the wampum, we have to find this belt. I've heard that it might be in a museum in Chicago, not the Field Museum, but one on the outskirts or suburbs of Chicago. A Siganok's belt, they say, or Blackbird's belt, they call it. But I never had the chance to go there yet to try and find it. And then if we really believe this about the wampum, that it actually records the speech, then we see that, and he says it too, the body of my words, in this the spirit of my words shall remain. That if we find that original wampum belt, then what we've been told by other people, especially my friend there, Seneca Rick Hill, says that their people, the Haudenosaunee people, say that whenever they speak words over the wampum, it records that. And if we're able to actually activate that, hopefully we'll be able to bring them back here. So this is the second page of the last page of the 1836 treaty. But here, the chiefs wrote, and that document I showed you of June 27, 1862, this is one of the last lines they wrote in Ojibwe. Minwa dash eko nishtana ashin gudwaswe eko da sobabonagak. Minwa ngi bi disaguna kche ugema. Ngi bi zongtamagana mandan minisimina je ap je debendamang ninwe anishinaabe oyang. So it says there, it's been 26 years ago since the governor, lieutenant governor, came and met us here. And he spoke to us in very strong terms about our owning these our island here, us who are Anishinaabeg. So he says that we own this island, meaning Manitoulin, outright. And that's what the governor had come here and said to us. And I like the way this is said, the way they worded this. In Ojibwe, some of you may know, you will have heard of people being called Zongagabwe, standing strong. And that's what this zong means, It means strong. So he said, in the strongest terms, he came and spoke to us and told us that we own this. This is Shingwa Kong's at Manitouaning, and he's actually wanting this council fire to be moved from Manitouaning to back to St. Joseph's Island, because he says it's too far for others of the around Lake Superior to come to Manitouaning. So he says, I will speak the sentiments of the Ojibwek Dawak Mino Abode Adamik. Father, you once made your great fire at the island of St. Joseph's, where you planted a tree such as you have planted here, and from which you have just now taken down your flag. And remember, on that metal, there's a tree. The tree was very tall and it could be seen from a great distance. Father, you have taken away the flagstaff and the flag under which your children were accustomed to recline and take shelter. And again, that idea of shelter and protection. When you laid your log, you said it would never burn out, but that the smoke from it would always be seen at a great distance. You told my ancestors to bring their children and warm their hearts at the fire of this log. But when I came past it, this place, I could not discern the spot where the tree stood. I cleared the place and made it clean around the log, and all of your young children have agreed to turn the log and see whether they can find a dry place where a fire may be kindled. And remember again how the importance of the fire here. The three tribes wish you would pull up the flagstaff which you have planted at this place and erected at the island of St. Joseph's where it originally stood. The three tribes have come here to obtain fire from our great father with which to rekindle the log, and that the smoke may rise from it as formerly, for it was not burned out. You promised that three generations should pass away, and yet we should find a fire burning at this log. Father, many of your children live at a great distance from this island, and there is a high hill between which prevents their seeing the fire which burns, or the flag which floats from the staff erected at this place. The high hill is actually the fort at Fort Brady on the American side. Many of your children have not yet seen. They are very poor. They have but little game left to subsist upon, and the traders are becoming very stingy. They sell their goods at a very high price. So that's just to show what the chiefs actually understood of the covenant chain. And it's this imagery of a tree, of a protection, as well as of a fire. And that the centrality and the importance of the fire. And again, like I said, our uncle here, Michiquin, had talked about that fire. So here, this is in 1851, the Indian agent, local Indian agent, superintendent, they called him, Ironside, had told him that the chiefs that at Manitouaning, at the delivery of presents, that within 4 years, they would discontinue the presents. So they all gathered together, and Mokmanish, Odawa chief Mokmanish, and the Bode Adami chief Wakao Se, and the Ojibwe chief Jigwa Kons, each responded to that news. And they said in English, what they said here was, Father, we heard your words and we believe when you said, you see that sun above us who daily shines to light and warm us. You see those green leaves that open out beneath his rays. You see that grass which clothes the earth, those waters which flow from the highlands towards the sea. Well, whilst these things live, your presence shall live. Can it be that this is forgotten? Father, shall the Indian no longer be able to draw home, which it has so often gladdened, that amply freighted vessel, which was bound by the strong cord of friendship, much merely to agitate, which you told him should make it appear. So, I worked with elders in Chiging, one being my father, Alvin Corbier, but also my friend, my late friend, Zenba Namit, Louis Debaskeba, and also and with Evelyn Roy, who continues to help me here in Chiging with the language. So we translated this Nos, Ki Nundago Ga Kidian, Minwagi Debwetago Pigi Kidian. Quab ma'au gizis spimming and sigijgak gil waskune we gijosiang. Quabin danan na newe jausko nibishan. Bin sakshkak epin Epingindas get Quabndan in the Mishkonsan Basconiet Totake Newe Nabin Binda Jwang Kche Gedakin Zitagnegamin Nakea Mbe a peach meads Bemad Zimogok Nanda a mean Mingo Wazuanan the Bemadadon Mina e dekmanda jene Ninjaga demagok. Nos, Kana Giabe de Kanishna begabime, Anjisek, Penegaje, Minuan gozit, Wegakche, Guzukskodek, Giman, Gat Kubedek, Mishko, Mishkoa, Witski Wendewin, Nengach, Kawikbidon, Mideshko, Jibagamskak. So these are the last few slides. I don't know how much time left I got, but this is Chief Potash, George Badash. It always says Potash, but I understand the name. That's my clock. I don't know if you could hear that, but anyway, and the way I understand this name is Badash. And if somebody comes sailing here or some bird comes soaring this way, that's what that name would be. That's a Mimanda Ejin Sastamang knows when Badash. They come sailing this way or soaring. That's what his name is. And he was a Crane clan chief, and standing beside him is John Crow, who was Ginuje. But they wrote down their understanding in Ojibwe about that gunshot treaty, as well as the Rice Lake Treaty of 1818. And in there, they referred to this, they didn't call it covenant chain, they just called it that the delivery of those presents and those promises. And so they said in Ojibwe, Minik ge ogojing o gizus, ge minik ge midjuang ini ozibawan, ge minik ge za ki gwe mijashk. As long as the sun, it literally says hangs, but as long as the sun is in the sky, and as long as the rivers flow, and as long as the grass comes out of the ground, that's what the promises that were made. Get in your ziba one, get minik, get zog keek, me jashk, we kaja eshqua sesinok, and dog we ego win. And he makes the same promise as the governor did to our grandchildren long ago. Below, as long as we see the sun, and as long as the river flows and the grass grows, that the supplies of clothing and blankets from the government shall never be stopped, as long as we live. So again, from Rice Lake up to Manitoulin Island and beyond, that's what they would associate those two, is that the rivers, as long as the rivers flow, the grass grows and the sun shines, that these promises would be upheld, and that they would give us clothing and warmth. So this one word, I didn't know what this last word was, and it's written in Ojibwe, and I had a hard time with it, and for a while I had a different word, but I finally found it. And so I looked in some old dictionaries, and it's Wilson, Reverend Edward F. Wilson says, clothe, he clothes him, adagui on, and then adagui eton, he clothes it, and then he provides himself clothing, agui ediza. And then agui win, but the giving or receiving of clothing, agui edewin. And then that's the last entry of that dictionary entry, but that's the word, the base of that word that I finally figured out in that petition dictated by George Badash. But Bishop Baraga in his dictionary says, aguia, I clothe him. And the other part here that's significant that I never heard anybody talk about, he says also, I give him clothes already made or clothing materials, aquia. also agui idemin, we clothe each other. And then agui ding, receiving clothes, presents or payment in clothes received by many together. Agui idwin, the giving or receiving of clothes or clothing materials as a present or payment. So that's the word that that I was stuck on for a while, but I ended up finding it, and that was in this particular petition, because when I read it in Ojibwe, I was like, they don't mention clothing here, what I thought, because they're just, but it's all encapsulated in that one word, ndagwi igowin. Ndagwi igowin is the payment that we receive in clothing that's given to us. That's what that that word means. Anyway, migo minik, I think I'm that's the last of my slides, but what I wanted to really show and try and emphasize to us is this idea that we have to look at our language, and we have to talk to our elders that speak the language. And bejika nishnabe mat nishnabe kwe bejina go gi ni gani o de nabising. So I saw on Facebook, I wanted to express my condolences to the people of Nabising at their recent loss as well. And I know Mike there, her son, as well, that this one lady had recently gone ahead of us. And now we see that, of course, we're going to have to rely on her from that side to help us here as well. But we need to actually work with our speakers more than we actually are at the moment. And it's even more urgent each time one of our speakers leave. We need them. We need somebody to actually replace them here as well. Gudingi widebemao mshike. At one of these sunrise ceremonies, I was sitting with our uncle Mshike, not just me, there was others there. And it was a meeting of the union, and it was held at Balk Ting. And he had said that he was doing his opening, and he was speaking in our language at that time. And then he had said that somebody had come up to him and said, well, doesn't the spirit understand everything? Meaning English too. So we don't need to learn our language if the spirit understands everything, is what this person had. Mahabadasha Nishnabe Ginanem Shikain. This is what this one person said to our elder. And then what Mashikain Gin Kwetwane, and what he responded to him to is, maybe you're right. Maybe the spirit does understand English and everything. But all those ancestors that are, all those ancestors, they don't understand that English. They're the ones that we're also relying upon. So when we address them, maybe they don't understand that English. Manda Shagana Shimuin. So he says that it's also imperative that we understand our language to speak and address our ancestors that are over there. The ones that sometimes they say that are hungry, that we have to feed them, and we feed them, and then we actually get them to assist us as well. So when we're working on these treaty documents, a lot of times, out of necessity, it seems we have a reliance, and I would think an over-reliance on the legal, on the Canadian law, on the Jaganashi Nakanagewin, and at the diminishment of our reliance on the Anishinaabe law. And so, and it's because of the situation that we have been in with colonization, as well as oppression, but now we're actually learning this more, and we're asserting it more. But what we have to do is actually do that in our language and exercise that in our medium and in our forum, meaning that we have to use Waganak, Shkude, Minwa, Miksa Biganak, and Minwa Miksak. We have to use that wampum, the wampum belts, those pipes, Minade Ganak, Rishi Ganak, and we have to rely on those elders, the speakers as well. And we have to try and learn that language in order to combat the Jagannath understanding of these treaties and the implementation of those treaties in the English framework. And the only way we're going to do that is if we actually really master our own language and our own ceremonies and our own ceremonial knowledge to enact that. I have more to say, but I think I ran out of time. I'm thankful that I got asked to come and speak a bit about this, but I just wanted to emphasize that, especially that when we lose somebody as prominent as they did in the Bising, that the efforts should be tripled to actually learn and to cherish those people that speak and that know, especially in communities where less and less people are speaking their language, that you cherish them, but you don't just cherish them, you work with them, and that you actually learn from them and you pick that up. So I say, dap nan, dap namak de nishna bemwin. Dap namak de nishna bemwin. Now pick up our language and use it.
On behalf of everyone, we have a few questions, and Sherry Lynn and Scott, if you're okay that we could do a few questions, we'll be able to manage all the time, if that's all right. I just want to say, Alan, we had one of our participants had to leave just a minute or two ago, and this, I think, sums it up for everyone. They're apologizing that they're leaving the meeting, and they just wanted to say Chi Miigwech to you for your teaching. You're an amazing teacher, and we're very lucky to have you and our elders like Gordon and Evelyn to guide us down a good path. And I'm sure everybody feels the same way. So Chi Miigwech for your teaching. Questions. First of all, where do these coins or medallions and the wampum belts, where do they live today? Where are they?
I know that the Pine family kept theirs from Jaguacons. So with that, and that's good. And recently I found out that there's a fella in Chimnisin, Christian Island, that also kept it's handed down to them. But about 10, 15 years ago, there was one that was actually from the Treaty of Niagara. And the special thing about that was it actually had the certificate that was given with the medal. And on the back of that certificate was each time that medal was handed down to a descendant, the next keeper, it actually was written on the back who it was given by and to and where. So it would say this one medal was given at Niagara in 1764 on August 1st to Neigomene or Egomene, Cornhanger. And then it was given to Anamsin. And then from Anamsin, they went to Sinabe. And at the back of each time, it was verified by the Indian agent, Thomas Gummersall Anderson, in one case, in two cases. And then after that, but what happened with that one is the person who was entrusted to keep it actually auctioned it off. So we lost that one. And it's in the hands of a private collector, whoever bought it at auction. Hmm. But in 2011, we had an exhibit at the Ojibwe Culture Foundation. And I borrowed a bunch of these medals from the Library and Archives collection. The Library and Archives of Canada have a medal collection. And so they had that, one of those medals from 1764, and we borrowed that, and we had it at the Ojibwe Culture Foundation on display, and then also some of those ones that were awarded during the War of 1812. So some of them are at the Royal Ontario Museum. So there are a number, that picture that I showed in the slideshow, those were all from the Royal Ontario Museum. Those are all, I lined them all up, and I took that picture when I was there at the ROM.
In the picture, Alan, that you showed just before the end of your presentation, is that the medals that the chiefs are wearing?
Yeah, yeah.
That's so they would wear them to that meeting.
Yeah, that's to any of these meetings that they had, they would wear those. And like I tried to emphasize, those medals become the mnemonic device. And then the chiefs had written there that it's that accompanies the wampum belt. So when we had a commemoration of the, I don't know if commemoration is the right word. Everyone gives me hell after I say that. When we had a gathering at Niagara in 2014, we had a gathering at Niagara and then at Fort George, and we tried to have a renewal of that. And what I was hoping was that anybody who had their medals to come down, and that if we were able to ever bring all those medals back together with the original wampum belt, and then to hopefully see if anybody had their collective and have a collective understanding and a collective sharing at that time, then maybe we would have a fuller understanding of this relationship. And I just think it would be powerful if we were able to have the descendants who had those medals come and wear their medals, come to the council fire and have the belts there, and then have a recitation, and then to actually have the British representatives there as well to hear that. And then for them, the other thing that I often say is for them to actually recite it back. And that's how this used to be renewed, is that they would actually recite that, so to show that they understand that. So one time I did this presentation, and a non-native lady actually phoned me up one time and said, can I touch that belt next time you talk? So I kind of laughed. I said, yeah, you can, of course. And that's actually what Tecumseh said that in one of his, one of the meetings. He says, everyone here is to touch this belt to show that they agree to it. So that's how we show that we would agree to it. And then the other thing I said to her, she says, can I talk about that belt? And I said, I wish you would. And she says, oh, I just thought it might be appropriation. I said, your ancestors are the ones that gave it to us. I said, imagine if all of you, your ancestors actually kept that understanding up, and we would be in a totally different place. If you all understood on your side, this belt has two sides. And if you actually understood your side and lived and abided by that, and we lived and abided by our side, things would be a lot different here on the Mshikem and Nisink.
I had a note from Randy Rastool, just to follow up with what you're saying. He said, Dokis has two medals, one before 1812 and one after. Question, there, because I have a couple of questions here, and Sherilyn and Scott will be right to you shortly. The question, in the spirit of this 1764 belt and with 1893 Statute Law Revision Act, 1931 Statute of Westminster, and the questionable 1982 Constitution Act, which was not ratified, and for the citizens of Canada, and is not a constitution, why are leaders not demanding Canada to address this outstanding constitutional question as per their own laws? I don't quite understand the question, but you're far smarter than me, Alan.
I thought that was to Scott and Sherry Lynn. Because it's about constitution, and it's about... I didn't even hear of that Westminster Law. So I can't, sorry, I can't answer the question.
No, that's all right.
Big thing is, like I was saying, is we got to learn this. And it's a big learning curve. And I know we got different, we get new chiefs. And I've heard, like I said, I've heard our uncle here, Mashika, say this numerous times, that we get new, he gets new chiefs, and then we got to bring them up to speed as well. And they haven't necessarily heard this wampum belt, or they haven't heard this teaching or that teaching. So it's a constant teaching that you have to keep giving. And that's why this wampum belt, why they would do it every year. And it wasn't just one chief or one speaker that knew this. And that's what I tried to show there, is that that Rice Lake chief actually knew it, and then Xinghua Kongs knew it, and then the chiefs at Chiging, the chief at Chiging was Bem Ganeshkang, and he's the one who ends up signing off on that. And then, of course, the keepers of that belt were living at Wikwan Kong at that time, and the keeper at that time was either Mok Manish or Jean-Baptiste Siganok. So it was kind of, I used to say, this learning this speech and knowing about this speech and would have been chieftainship 101. And that's what Shikan used to talk about, that he would talk to the chiefs, and it's chieftainship 101, that there would be a kind of a course for that. And that, to me, that would be one of the things that we have there, is to actually say that this wampum belt and all the promises that go with it is chieftainship 101, part of chieftainship 101.
The letters that or some of the documents that you were showing from, I think, 1700s had incredible penmanship. And was it, who was writing this, and was the British interpreting or understood the language and they knew how to write it, or was it the chiefs that were writing? Who formulated these documents?
That one particular one that I showed you, I haven't figured out who actually wrote it. I looked at the priests, the Jesuit priests who were in Wikwan Kong at the time, and I got all of their, not all of them, but I got each of them, their samples of their handwriting, and I had put it beside that document. It doesn't look like it was the Father Chaunet, Auguste Collaire. It wasn't them too. And the nearest one, it might have been Brother Geniso, but I don't think it was him either. Now, that being said, we know that the and get learn to read and write. And in fact, the chief Bem Asage, who was a Odawa chief at Wikwan Kong, he was also known as Waka Gijik. His son was named Metsagi. And then after the 1862 treaty, he actually went around to Shishiguan and Chiging, and he actually wrote out in Ojibwe a petition on each behalf of those communities, Wikwan Kong, Chiging, and Shishiguaning, asking to annul the 1862 Manitoulin Treaty. He wrote that in Ojibwe, but his handwriting is very distinctive and it isn't the same one. And then also Edewish Kosh, who is Jean-Baptiste Siganok's son, could write in Ojibwe, as well as his other son, Francis Siganok. And so there are a number of different candidates, chief's sons, but I've never been able to determine definitively who was the actual scribe of that particular petition.
There's a number of questions here about constitution. We'll maybe park those for a second. We might, because we want to hear from Sherilyn and Scott in a moment. But there was an early question about, it said, was Canada the actual term used, or a different word or term of understanding?
In that particular instance in 1764, when he said we became possessed of Canada, that's what he used at that time. And living with now what we would then call the American, United States of America. Of course, that didn't exist, but he called it Canada. And the reason they call it Canada is because of the French, the outposts, eh? And the association with French people. But it was just for the posts, meaning Detroit, Michilimackinac, and any other posts that they had established.
Alan Chimiguich, it was so good, and we could spend a lot of time here. I want to hear more. I did provide a link to everyone that's attending that shows more of your teachings on YouTube, so you'd be able to go to that link. And Alan has many teachings of wampum and some of the different wampums and the stories behind them. I encourage everyone to view those, and encourage, if we get a chance to hear from Alan again, that we sit and listen and learn. Chimiguich.
Okay, Miigwech. Honey, Scott.
Okay, let's move to our next topic. Sherilyn Johnson is here, also Scott Robinson as well, talking about First Nation case study on the environmental protection regulatory and capacity gap. I will hand it over to both of you. I'm not sure who's speaking first, but welcome both of you to get us started.
Yes, thank you very much. Thank you, Alan. That was a great presentation. I don't mind. I could have stayed listening to you the whole presentation. So I want to say welcome, and we're going to do a presentation today to talk about some of the regulatory gaps. But I want to thank Evelyn and Gordon for all their words this morning and their openings and their prayers. And just going to see if I can share my screen. Yes, okay. So bonjour, Ami. My name is Sherilyn Johnston Dishnakaz, Deshken Zibi Donjaba. And I am from Chippewas of the Thames First Nation, but I work for Anjanong First Nation. And I hope everybody can hear me. I'm trying to maneuver through this.
Yeah, I believe we can hear everything. We can see.
Okay, I'm just trying to find where I can start my slideshow here.
If you go over to slideshow, go right to slideshow at the top there where it says file home. Go over to slideshow to your right.
Yeah, so there's insert, but the top panel is kind of covering it. So it's insert, then there's another word and another one. Can you tell me when I'm on slideshow?
Yeah, can you click on slideshow?
No.
See slideshow, it's right next to animations.
I can see it, but I can't click on it because the top panel from my thing is there. Okay, here we go.
Got it. And then, then it should be from the beginning. There you go.
There we go. Okay. So what we had a couple of presentations yesterday about regulatory gaps. And that's the part that I want to talk about, because this is how Anjanong First Nation handled that regulatory gap issue. You know, we are in an area that deals with a lot of pollution, and we have been suffering for years. And, you know, it's been hard to really push the government into making sure that, you know, the regulations that they are mandated to perform and look after are actually enforced in the territory. So I just wanted to tell a little bit of our story. So Anjanong First Nation is located on the shores of St. Clair River, and it's a beautiful area. It's just at the mouth of Lake Huron, and the Anishinaabe here in Anjanong are very, they have a diverse and vibrant culture. And, you know, you can see through some of the pictures that, you know, we still have a lot of the performing of the powwow, the ceremonies A lot of activities, a lot of culture being portrayed in the artists and artwork that are out, all through the community, actually. And one of the things that Omjanong is, you know, kind of consistently identified with is Chemical Valley. The area is home to several dozen large facilities, and it represents 40% of Canada's chemical industry. And as a result of this concentration of industrial facilities, Sarnia suffers some of the worst air pollution in Canada. And that's not only just, you know, anecdotally Omjanong saying it, it's actually been acknowledged by quite a few, I would say, you know, overseers of the government. So the Environmental Commissioner of Ontario has put a report out. The Auditor General of Ontario has also put a report out about, you know, the industrial facilities and the impacts to Omjanong. So the World Health Organization also indicated that, you know, that we do suffer some of the worst air pollution in Canada. And most recently, the UN Special Rapporteur on Toxins also talked about some of the impacts that the industry has on the Omjanong First Nation. So because we're surrounded by industry, you know, this industry was developed and, you know, it happened without any consultation with the community. And it was developed, you know, back in the 1900s, like, and actually the 1800s when they first discovered oil and oil springs. And because it was developed without any kind of consultation and planning, we can see that, you know, Omjanong here, you can look at one of these where we, the picture on the bottom right, where we have the Omjanong sign for our learning facility, and right across the road is, you know, a chemical producer, INEOS Styrolutions. It used to be Nova Chemicals, but it's now INEOS. And you can see all of the, you know, large stacks, and you can see a little flare going off. And those are the kinds of issues that Omjanong is dealing with. And you can also see the heavy industrial facilities from the water side. So this is where we're located. This is some of the area at the bottom where we have, you know, the Omjanong territory is all in green. And then you have, you know, Suncor and some of the other industrial facilities on both sides of it. So we are surrounded, we are fence line neighbors of industry, and we do experience adverse effects in a multitude of ways from some of the toxic chemicals that are emitted to the air in every day. Some of these decontaminants include sulfur dioxide, which is a precursor for some respiratory diseases. Benzene has shown the health risk related to cancer, which is can be specific to leukemia for all routes of exposure, meaning dermal inhalation and ingestion. And 1,3-butadiene also has the same cancer type of link as leukemia, and it's by inhalation. So one of the things that I like to point out is that, you know, Omjanong, we can't choose the air we breathe. You know, where we're located, the air that we are, you know, subject to is the air that we do have to breathe. And we can't choose that. You know, we might be able to choose, you know, some of the water we drink. You know, we can buy bottled water and different things. But when it comes to air, you know, we are subject to what is in our territory. And the other thing that I wanted to also point out is that, you know, air is not an easy medium to monitor, to control, and to determine what's in it, because it is, you know, something that you can't see. Water, on the other hand, you know, you can see if there's a spill in it, or you can see if there's something that isn't right with respect, and they can model it a little bit easier. So air is definitely a harder and more complex type of medium to monitor. So one of the things that we've been doing for some time now is to really push and advocate for additional monitoring of contaminants in the community. So in 2008 or 2007, 2008, we were able to, have a full air monitoring station situated on in the territory right next to the health center. So that is a full monitoring station with all of the, the ambient air quality machinery and its real-time data. And it also has a mass spec GC. We also do canisters for, polyaromatic hydrocarbons. So we do a full station, but we were saying that because we only had one station, we needed additional monitors in key areas. So by our daycare center, by our community center, closer to where industry is located, just because when you have more monitors, you're able to better determine impact and also determine source. So we had involvement and that's the other thing that I want to bring out is that when you're working with governments and you're working with industry, you have to be involved. So you have to be at the table to understand what they're doing, because when you're not there, they can develop things without your input. And then that's where, you can run into issues. So one of the things that Omgenong did was, we were involved in the development of the Ontario Petroleum Petrochemical Industry Standard for benzene and 1,3-butadiene. And one of the things that we were able to really push for was for fence line monitoring or property line monitoring. And that's a new type of passive sampling where you don't need any, electricity, you don't need any large equipment. You just have a little shroud with a cylinder that has a medium in it that is specific for those type of contaminants. And it's something that's been happening in the States for quite some time. And the government, when they did this industry tech standard, put that in as a requirement. And it was one of the things that we really pushed for. And it's really been helping us determine, what the numbers are at our fence line. So, and the next contaminant that we look at is sulfur dioxide. So when we talked about monitors being installed, we did indicate that because of we have concerns with a lot of acid gas flaring that goes on in the industry. And when that happens, there's high levels of SO2. And it's been reported in nearby Port Huron in Michigan County. So it's not just, Omgenong that is saying, we have issues with it and, we can smell it and it's causing us, issues along with the particulate matter that, causes a lot of asthma in the community. And when it comes to, jurisdictions, the province regulates the benzene and the sulfur dioxide coming from these industries, but the Canadian federal government also has some involvement. And when Port Huron had indicated that they were in non-attainment for SO2 levels, the Canadian federal government went, across the border and met with Port Huron and, the US EPA in Michigan and had a big meeting about the non-attainment. And when they went over to Michigan, they had to drive right through, the Omgenong, like right past the Omgenong community. And we've been telling them for years that we've had problems with SO2 and they didn't even stop. They just right through the territory and right over to meet with Michigan and, not even being transparent with us about what they were doing and what those petrochemical facilities were contributing to the Port Huron data. So there's a flag for us saying, when it comes to the community saying we have an issue, what jurisdictions are actually out there making sure that, the facilities don't impact us. But because we've been advocating for years, we've got some new monitors that are established in the territory, and they're measuring much higher levels of benzene 1,3-butadiene and SO2 than were expected. And the SO2 levels are what we call in the red zone for the SO2 Canadian Ambient Air Quality Standard. So that just gives you an idea that, for the Canadian Ambient Air Quality Standard, for us to be in the red zone and not to have any kind of dialogue or meetings, it's, you know, concerning. So when we had the new monitors in, what they showed is that sulfur dioxide is 10 times higher than other communities such as Ottawa and Toronto, and they're 6 times higher than US communities with heavy industry. So, you know, if you look at the Contra Costa California community, they have a heavily industrialized, you know, with refineries similar to what we have in Sarnia. And our community is 6 times higher than that heavy industrialized area in the US. And the same with benzene. We have 30 times higher than other communities such as Ottawa and Toronto, and 10 times higher than the US community with heavy industry. So when you do that comparison, it says that, you know, we do have and suffer from air quality issues. So 1,3-butadiene is also, you know, made from rubber plants. So we have our Lang CO here, used to be Polysar, and, you know, they are rubber producers, and they're 27 times higher than other communities for 1,3, Amgenong is for 1,3-butadiene. So higher than other communities such as London and Ottawa, and 1.5 times higher than Rubber Town in Louisville, Kentucky. So these are, you know, numbers that, you know, should be causing an issue with the regulators. And, you know, when Chief Plain met with Environment Canada a year and a half ago, or a year and a half ago, you know, we were told that Amgenong was unique. And Chief Plain said, no, you know, this is an environmental crisis here. It's not a unique situation, and you need to get a hold of it. So that was some of the issues. So for us, we have my voice is gone. Scott, can you take over on this for a minute?
Yeah, no problem, Sherilyn. Thank you very much. I just introduced myself very quickly, Scott Robertson. I'm a lawyer working with Niall Gabel-Corbière. I've had the pleasure of working with Sherilyn in the Amgenong community for in excess of 12 years. Just wanted to say very quickly, thank you to the organizers. Thank you to Gordon, the elder, for your kind words and instructions. Thank you to pleasure always to speak and listen to Alan Corbière. And just before I jump in here, I just wanted to say, in terms of how this fits into the conference in a larger kind of aspect, I just went back and looked at the goals in terms of the Anishinaabeg goals and the purposes. And it was interesting to read in terms of one of the goals was to build positive working relationships with each First Nation, our citizens, governments, industry, and academia. And so it's this portal into what's happening in Amgenong is interesting, if that's your goal in developing relationships, because we can, as Sherilyn has been able to point out, these relationships have been extremely one-sided and in complete disregard for what Alan has basically spoken very eloquently about, the original treaty relationship with the Crown, and the way it's been denigrated to today is quite disturbing. The original relationships of, you know, if you're looking at wampum belts and the idea of the two-row wampum of maintaining sovereignty within our canoes has extremely been set aside, I would say, in the nicest way. And also I looked at the goals, and one of the achievements that you're looking for is to maintain a balance in the natural environment. And it's pretty clear to see from the information that's been provided by Sherilyn in the development of air monitoring, just specifically looking at 3 of the toxic chemicals that are released into the air. There's a huge disparity in terms of the natural environment, but with respect to the covenant change, in terms of a harmonious relationship, I would say that this is anything but harmonious. So looking at who's responsible in terms of providing the regulations and guidelines and the law in terms of protecting Amgenong, you can see from the provincial regulatory control and enforcement, there's a definite lack of those regulations. And you'll see Ontario Petroleum Refineries are not required to have the same level of air pollution controls as U.S. refineries. And most people may find that shocking living in Canada. You know, the Americans tend to have somewhat of a poor reputation when it comes to protecting the environment. That's not true. And the regulatory schemes and the monitoring that's coming out of the United States are reflective of that. You'll see that Ontario refineries have higher flaring emissions, higher catalytic cracking unit emissions, and higher sulfur contents in refinery fuels as compared to their U.S. refineries. There's a lack of regulation in Ontario related to the emission and flow monitoring for sulfur dioxide emissions. And overall, there's a lack of enforcement by Ontario to reduce sulfur dioxide emissions. So what does that mean? Well, there are regulations, but Ontario, for some reason, habitually refuses to enforce the regulations that are even lower than the regulations that are set out in the United States. And what this does is eventually it's increasing the risks for the people of Amgenang, but also the people of Sarnia and generally the people of Ontario. Next slide, Sherilyn.
Okay. Do you want me to take over?
Sure.
Okay. Yep. Thanks for that. Sorry. So one of the things that when we talk about Ontario and we talk about regulations, one of the air quality regulation is Ontario Regulation 41905. And, you know, they have a, you know, Ontario has a compliance approach. So they have three different compliance routes. One is air standard, where you comply with the numeric air contaminant air standard. And if you can't do that, then you can actually apply for a technology-based standard where it can be, you know, a site-specific standard or it can be a technical standard, which is basically a sector-based or equipment-based standard. And that's where they put, you know, different kinds of criteria and controls on the facilities in order that they, you know, can reach that overall compliance number, but it will take them, you know, 10 to 15 or 20 years, depending on how long they think it is before they can get in best available control technology or, you know, move down the road to actually reducing their, you know, feedstocks or whatever it is that they're using that will increase either the sulfur dioxide or the benzene number. So, and the other thing that, you know, they use air dispersion modeling. So a lot of the environmental compliance approvals that come through look at what comes out of the stack. And as it disperses or they model it with the numbers of the height of the stack, the type of, you know, pollutant that's coming out and all kinds of other parameters actually get to a point of impingement number. So that's where they base a lot of their standards on, as well as point of impingement. So where actually the dispersion actually hits the ground and impinges on the area. So again, here's the primary regulations that go into an environmental compliance approval or an ECA for air. And, you know, like the ECA is a permit and it's required for any changes to air emissions. And it's also, you know, something that all of these companies that are in this territory or in the Amgenang or in the Chemical Valley all need an environmental compliance approval. And this compliance approval is issued by the minister or by the director and of Ontario, the environmental, Ministry of Environment, Conservation and Parks. And, you know, they have to look at it under all of the air regulations and the air Ontario Reg 41905, but also they have to determine whether or not it causes adverse effects. And so once they can figure out what the point of impingement is and whether or not it meets their criteria and will be under the standard, they'll issue an environmental compliance approval. Now, in my time that I've been working with the Amgenang, but also, you know, in my time working with the ministry as well, I've never seen an environmental compliance approval not be issued. So they always, you know, provide some sort of conditions or provide something in the compliance approval to make sure that they can, you know, go ahead and emit those contaminants to air. So there's never been one that I know of that's not been issued, but, you know, somebody might be able to tell me differently, but all of the ones that are come through my desk usually do get issued. So the other part of the regulations are the federal regulatory control. And we say there's a lack of it because, you know, really when it comes to the feds, I've never seen anybody come down to the or meet with, you know, the Environment Department or the Environment Committee. We've went there a couple of times with our chief and our consultant and our lawyer to talk about some of these issues. But, you know, it's been very limited in how we work together with the federal regulatory agencies. And they have a couple of, you know, controls or I guess regulations, and one is the National Pollutant Release Inventory or NPRI, and industry reports their annual emissions. So they'll report how much SO2 or benzene, you know, they're releasing into air, and it'll be in tons per year. But this data is not verified and it's self-reporting. So, you know, we always wonder about that, like, you know, whether or not the emissions are actually, you know, true. Because of the fact that there's no oversight. There's also a VOC regulation that just was promulgated in by the feds regarding leak detection and repair. And this regulation is less stringent than the existing Ontario requirements. But when we did provide our comments to the Crown, you know, one of the things that we indicated is that, you know, they were forgetting about certain sources. So, you know, they were doing some LDAR, which is leak detection and repair, but they were forgetting about the wastewater treatment facilities that are on site for most of these companies and also tanks. And when we get to the notice of violation, you'll see that the main reason why we issued that notice of violation was because of a tank issue. So again, the Canadian ambient air quality standards are less stringent than Ontario for the standard for SO2, and there's no enforcement mechanism. And I think, you know, when we look at all of the different things that are happening in the territory, I think it's very important that we be involved with all of the different types of agencies that deal with air pollution, because the Anjanong, you know, when we're not invited to participate, it really sends a message that there's an issue with, you know, the oversight and the enforcement and the regulatory control, and it's a violation of the Anjanong's rights. So I think this is where, you know, I'll turn it back over to Scott, and he can provide some, I guess, information about what the Environmental Commissioner issued in their findings for a number of years.
Yes, thank you very much, Sherilyn. I think it's important to realize here that oftentimes people will say there's lack of capacity in First Nations in dealing with, you know, the multitude of environmental regulations and responsibilities that the government then throws onto the First Nation. But in this particular case, I'd say that's not true. Sherilyn herself used to work for the Ministry of Environment or the Ministry in Ontario. And I hope I'm not getting you in trouble by saying that, Sherilyn, but what that brings to the table is a multitude of expertise, right? Sherilyn is very aware of how regulations are developed, how they're enforced, how they're regulated themselves. And so there's a very strong understanding. There's also a strong participation. Anjanong has been involved in these discussions on environment for quite some time, as long as I've been involved and actively involved, meaning third-party consultants have been hired to review the data, to question what's going on. We've made multiple submissions at all levels of government, both federal, provincial, municipal, with respect to these issues. We've been highly involved in these things. And despite all of that, despite what we've been talking about, the situation is not getting better. And this goes back, you can see the slide in front of you. This is the Environmental Commissioner of Ontario. They used to produce an annual report. This is from 2013-14. I say used to because Doug Ford basically eliminated this position. So now there is no oversight. There's no Environmental Commissioner of Ontario overseeing these type of things, which is extremely concerning from Amgenang's perspective, but also from Ontario residents from across the province. But these are the actual words from the report itself. Now, this is an independent body, right? Mandated to produce these type of things and to monitor the environment. And so you can see from the findings here, right? You have 110 million kilograms of pollution were released into the air in 2009. About 60% of this volume was released within 5 kilometers of Amgenang First Nation. And then specifically, the environmental commissioner noted the way Ontario regulates air emissions on a standalone facility by facility basis is at least partially to blame for these high pollution loadings. Then he goes on to say, there is no consideration given to the potential cumulative or synergistic impacts on human health or the environment locales where emitters are clustered. This is a damning finding by the environmental commissioner. And so following that, if you can go on to the next slide, please, Sherilyn. We also have some pretty strong evidence from the UN Special Rapporteur. So this is a special committee that's struck by the United Nations. They specifically chose Canada. They invited community groups, First Nations organizations from Canada to make submissions as to why the UN Rapporteur should come to your area and what was the purpose. So we wrote to the UN Rapporteur. And this was specifically looking at toxins and hazardous substances. And we said, you need to come to Amgenang. And we listed a whole bunch of reasons why, environmental commissioner reports, the environmental committees. We had all kinds of submissions as to why they should come. And so they did. They came in 2019. They met with community members. They met with the government. They met with elders. They came right into the community and did a tour of the facilities and whatnot. And the report was reproduced in September of 2020. And you can see the report of the Special Rapporteur on the implications for the human rights of environmentally sound management and disposal hazards. And you can see in the findings, the second paragraph here, the Special Rapporteur visited Amgenang, Sarnia, and found their situation, and these are his words, the Rapporteur, to be profoundly unsettling. The report also stated that the overlapping jurisdictions among the territories, the provinces, and the federal government, notwithstanding the cross-jurisdictional impacts of toxic exposure, contribute to the lack of clarity on the proper forum for seeking justice. So this is a very large concern put forward by the UN Rapporteur, saying that because of the way the structured of the government, right, where you have a federal, provincial, territorial kind of governments doing a little bit of both, this actually contributes to the high level of toxins that are being emitted from a lot of these facilities. If you can go to the next slide, please, Sherilyn. And most importantly, from the Rapporteur's report, you see that, and this is what was noted, various interlocutors, so people that obviously came forward to speak to the UN Rapporteur, acknowledged that existing regulations do not protect the health of Amgenang, period. Improvements can be made in investigating health impacts, conducting proper monitoring, and enforcing existing standards. And then he goes on, more importantly, to say that cumulative impacts remain of grave concern regarding the manner in which risks are assessed. The environment injustice is an ongoing tragedy, a legacy of land use planning that would not be allowed today. So essentially what he's saying there is these are being regulated, they're being monitored, but nothing's changing, right? And this is directly leading to the risks and the ongoing tragedy. And he basically says, you know, there's a structure in place in terms of the land use. You've had such a high concentration of facilities in a very small space right next to and all around Amgenang First Nation. Much of the land that has been ceded by Amgenang over the years was directly used to build these facilities. And so now you've created this environment in which the regulations do not protect Amgenang. Next slide, please. So you've got the UN Declaration of Rights of Indigenous People. You can see that Canada adopted the UN Declaration in 2020. There is a bill put forward to fully implement INDREP into Canadian law. Interestingly, Article 32 of UNDRIP, you'll see Indigenous peoples have the right to determine and develop priorities and strategies for the development or use of their lands or territories. And then part three of that, you know, it states that states shall provide effective mechanisms for the just and fair redress for any such activities, and appropriate measures shall be taken to mitigate adverse environmental, economic, social, cultural, or spiritual impacts. These are requirements under UNDRIP. And we heard previously in this conference about UNDRIP and some of the things that First Nations can do to apply that to their circumstances. So these are specifically identified in UNDRIP. So essentially the takeaway to this point is Sherilyn has shown you provincial, federal regulations that are falling short. You see all kinds of reports that have been provided identifying the problem. You have the United Nations rapporteur themselves identifying the issue, and you have UNDRIP, which obligates states to do certain things to be able to protect all this. But yet here we are. We're here in 2021 with a very large problem that's noted, that's been heavily monitored and identified, and yet nothing changes. So next slide, please, Sherilyn. Without any other recourse, what has happened in Amjinong is we've been provided instructions by Chief and Council through community forums and consultation to say, look, we need to take matters into our own hands, because in this lack or gap of regulatory, what I would call back and forth, Amjinong has to be able to protect its community members. And so what happened in this particular case was on a very specific issue dealing with a specific company, under its own inherent jurisdiction, Amjinong issued a notice of violation, very similar to what the province should be doing in terms of filing notice of violations under its regulations for those companies that violate the regulations, right? And so in September 2020, there was a notice of violation issued by the First Nation to INEO Styrolutions. And what they were saying is they need to implement control options for benzene. So benzene in this case was the particular chemical that had showed very high signs of emission. This was, you know, very well documented. And in that specific notice of violation, we noted things that we wanted INEOS to specifically address. And these were things that INEOS had in its control. These were things that were very identified with respect to where the emissions were coming from. So it wasn't a blanket, you need to fix things. These were very specific asks. And so the notice of violation laid all that out, laid out the jurisdiction in which it was being used. It also relied on the fact that many of these regulations were also included in Ontario's provincial regulations. And so you'll see there's a replaced tank 8. It's a large tank storage facility. They wanted to, we requested that they replace tank 8, install a fume collection and control system. We asked for enhanced oversight and robust auditing of the leak detection and repair system at INEOS. We also asked that they install additional enhanced real-time monitoring of benzene to track down any other fugitive sources. So these were very tangible, practical solutions that would immediately address some of the issues that have been identified. And the important part of this is a couple things. There's a couple takeaways from this. One is what is going to be the response, both from the provincial government and also the company themselves. We've been working with a consultant out of the United States who's very well versed in the Environmental Protection Act in the United States. And much of what we're asking them to do is what would happen in the United States, and has also come across very positive results. Where the EPA in the United States, because it's federally regulated in the United States, the states don't actually have the power to regulate the environment in the United States, unlike Canada, where it seems to be both federal and provincially regulated. So the EPA has a lot of power in the United States, and they can literally file a notice similar to this, a notice of violation. And if the company doesn't take direct action, the next step is the EPA will shut down your facility. They will just shut it down under the condition that unless you fix this and until you can prove that you fix this, this facility will remain shut down. We don't have the same regulations in Ontario or Canada to do so. So we're actually trying to push the envelope from the perspective of, these are inherent rights. It would be pretty easy to show that Amjinong is, in terms of their Aboriginal and treaty rights, are being severely impacted by, you know, these regulations that aren't being enforced. So, that, I mean, those are two things that we're using to assert, both inherent under the Chinook Neguayan constitution of Amjinong, we're asserting those rights. And we're also asserting Section 35 under the constitution rights to say that these type of situations where this emitting and this pollution is being allowed to operate under the regulations and the guidelines of Ontario is improper, and it needs to stop. But in doing so, we're creating a regulatory scheme by which Amjinong will also monitor and look at these regulations. And when there is a violation, they'll be providing their own notice of violation. So it is taking this regulatory gap, we'll call, and if it is a gap, the Amjinong will fill that space with its own jurisdiction. And so we're still in that process. It has been responded to. We've received correspondence from the government that they're looking at in terms of the violation itself and what needs to be addressed. So we're still in a wait to see what's going to happen next with respect to this process, but we are hopeful and somewhat confident that there will be a positive response. So the next slide, please, Sherilyn. So just in closing, with respect to protecting Amjinong's environment, I think it's important to go back to first principles and dealing where we came from Alan Corbière and what he was talking about this morning. It's important to see in terms of and remind ourselves that this comes from the Truth and Reconciliation Commission from their final report. And I think it was a pretty good summary. You can see that for over a century, the central goals of Canada's Aboriginal policy were to eliminate Aboriginal governments, to ignore Aboriginal rights, to terminate the treaties, and through a process of assimilation, cause Aboriginal peoples to cease to exist as distinct legal, social, cultural, religious, and racial entities in Canada. And I would argue that what's happening now with the environmental policies is a continuation of this policy. Right. If you make it so that First Nations people can't live on their land because the environment has become so soured, that is a continuation of this policy. And so those are the kinds of things that we look at when we're dealing with these issues. And we have to be aware of the fact, right? There certainly is I don't have any further comments, Sherilyn, if you have any closing remarks, and then perhaps we could enter into some conversation or answer some questions.
Sure. Okay, thanks, Scott. I just want to bring out a little bit more of the notice of violation and what we were able to do in the monitoring aspect of it when we were looking at the property line. When we were looking at the property line monitoring data, we were able to see that INEOS, because it's a neighbor, a fence line neighbor, when the numbers were high at that property line, as soon as it came over into Amjinong, we considered that a violation of our rights because of the fact that, you know, our First Nations territory needed to be considered. And, you know, for years, probably about 2 years during that property line monitoring, we're able to see the numbers, continually being over what the government had indicated would be their monitoring assessment value of 30 micrograms per meter cubed, which we didn't agree with as well. We thought it should be much lower, around 9. So there was a big discussion around that as to how they came up with that number. But so that was the, the whole idea behind the notice of violation, is that because we saw those numbers and because we had the data, we were able to take that and put it right into our notice of violation to say, here's the reasons why we're able to issue this, is because you're impacting our territory and you are violating our rights through that. So one of the things that I pointed out to the government as well is that, there's nothing stopping us with issuing a notice of violation to them, as, that might be the next step. Like, you have a mandate, you have regulations, you're responsible for that. And if you're not doing it, then you could be also subject to Amjinong's notice that you're violating their rights. So when we were able to take that notice of violation and put it to the company. We also sent one to the government to say, this is what we're doing. And so they had put an order on them, and that order was to look at and hire an expert to talk about tank 8 and how you were going to fix it. And, you know, and things were moving very slowly. So then when we issued the notice of violation, all of a sudden a second order came up from the government to this industry to say, if you don't have that tank 8 under control by March 31st, 2021, then you have to take it out of service, which is what we were asking them from the very beginning to do. And so that's why I think, you know, it's important when you start taking these types of issues in your own hands and letting the industry and government know that, you know, you are totally, you know, have your inherent jurisdiction and you have your rights that, you know, you're, and the community has said that. We want our own environmental standards, our own environmental regulations, and our own environmental people handling that. So when we talked to you know, the government yesterday about regulatory gaps, and somebody brought up the idea of having environmental officers and having it funded, I think that's an important part of, you know, looking at those regulatory gaps. It needs to be done. And I think that's where we need to have, you know, the chiefs and, you know, our leaders put that forward to the government to say, you know, she said, you know, sometimes what is important doesn't necessarily get moved up to the priority. And I think we need to take this in into that priority and say, you know, this is what needs to be done to handle, you know, the environmental issue on First Nations. I think the other thing that we've talked about in the community is the tribal program, and looking at, you know, what's happening in the U.S. Is fully supported. And it was also reaffirmed by the Trump, you know, government, which I found really, you know, quite unusual, because, you know, he wasn't really that open to, you know, First Nations and tribes. So, but he did, you know, again, provide all of the funding for the tribal programs to continue. So I think that's an important part that we need to look at as to how it's being done in the U.S. around these tribes. And the tribes, you know, the Navajo Nation, for one, has been doing it for years, and they're well-versed in it. So I think we can use that as a model and move forward in, you know, environmental stewardship on First Nation with environmental programs that we enforce and we look after. So I think that's all that I had to say, and I'll go on mute, ask if there's any questions.
Yes, and Sherilyn and Scott, thank you so much for your presentation. I don't know if it makes me feel much better after that. So actually, one of the questions comes in, it says, if not already, it says, Sherilyn and Scott, if not already, I see a real Aaron Brockovich lawsuit for its members and all local residents in the surrounding area. Is this something to be considered?
Yeah, I can take that one, Sherilyn. So lawsuits, sure. I mean, difficult, right? Obviously, to prove the nature thereof, because what will happen in that situation is the industry will say, well, you can't determine which of us is polluting. It may be cumulative, but where is it coming from? So, yeah, and it's very costly, and, you know, it'll be, you know, but yes, there certainly are claims that are available. But it goes back to, you know, it goes back to what Alan was talking about with respect to the special relationship between the Crown and Indigenous people, First Nations people. And I think it's incumbent upon them. Like, we First Nations people get lumped into this like public stakeholder kind of assessment, right? Where we're like a public stakeholder group, and we're basically putting forward our issues and our concerns. And that's not how First Nations should be treated. They should be at the table. They should be specifically recognized for the fact that they have rights that are that are constitutionally protected, but also stemming back to the covenant chain. And it shouldn't take a lawsuit. It should be something well more established. It should be in the regulations themselves, the development, the enforcement. That's where First Nations people should be. It shouldn't be something that we have to take through a Canadian court and spend a copious amount of money to argue our rights. It should never come to that. And so, yes, courts are always available to make those arguments, but it should be much more of a respectful relationship. And if we're going to talk about true reconciliation, it shouldn't be through the lens of litigation that we talk about it.
It's a great point. Thanks. I don't have any other questions at this point. I want to thank you both very much for this eye-opening, sobering presentation that you put for us before us in this case study. So miigwech to both of you for putting this together and the great work you're doing as well on behalf of all of us.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Oh, so if hello. I can get this. Sorry.
Oh,
sorry,
it's
Marianne.
That's all right.
I raised my hand, but I guess you can't see
I'm sorry,
it.
I didn't see that's it. Okay. Go ahead, Marianne.
Yeah. I just want to say miigwech for the presentation. And acknowledge everybody that has participated so far with the elder and the opening. And I just want to say, well, I'm from Omgenong too. And I really appreciate the work of these two people here, Scott Robertson and Sherilyn. They're true champions for Omgenong right now. And they have been for the past decade almost. And I'm really happy about all the work they've done. I just wanted to mention, let me see, the fact that we've had a health study done, and then I know there's something still in the works, so I'm wondering if Sherilyn can touch on that as well. And also, can you speak to the cancer rate? Our rate is higher here than in the surrounding area. I always believe that. And I think it's so important that those things be noted. And I think that all the other nations, if they can still, if they can learn about that and know about the issues that we deal with daily, I think that the unity that we need and the support that we need from the 39 nations behind us, I think that's really going to help our cause. And I wanted to speak to Ron Plain. He did a human rights challenge, Ron Plain and Ada Lockridge. And if Sherilyn, if you can talk to that a little bit, sure. That would be great.
Yeah, and thank you, Marina. I want to acknowledge Marina too, because Marina's been on council for 4 years, but she's also been on our environment committee for 6 years. So when we talk notice of violation, we talk all the work that's being done. She's been a strong supporter of our work, and has been like the real champion behind all this. So miigwech, Marina. So we do have a Sarnia Area Environmental Health Study that, has been something that's been in the works since 2007. that was back when Ron Plain and Ada were all part of the Environment Committee, Ada Lockridge. And they're both been strong advocates for the community. And so finally, there was a global news piece that was done on Omgenong, and I think it was Minister Ballard was the Minister of the Environment at the time. And so feeling the pressure from the media, one of the things that he did is he said that he would support the health study. Prior to that, we couldn't find the funding. Nobody would support the health study. So that is now being, it's in the works. So we've had 2 years of working with the government on that, what it looks like and what is an exposure study and what is it going to be when it comes to the community. And as far as cancer rates, there's a lot of anecdotal stories related to cancer since I've been here. I've been here since 2007. And, you know, I've had 10 people that I've worked with at least pass away due to cancer. And when you look at our deaths in the community, we probably lose a community member a month, according to like the stats on in our audit on how much we spend on graves and on funerals. And when you times that out, it works out to be about one person a month that we lose to an illness, whether that be cancer, heart disease, those types of things. And I don't want to make everybody feel bad. I know that Scott was saying that he wasn't, feeling good after all this. But the big thing that I want everybody to take away from it is that, you know, we are working making sure that our that we assert our rights. So using notice of violation is a way to do it, and to get rid of that regulatory gap that we're all facing. Start putting these types of tools and instruments in play, and it will be better for your community, because you will have the control and you can say, these are the conditions, this is what we want done. And, they can come back to the government and say, we're not going to do that. And the government can say, fine. But most of the time, if you say to the government, like, well, maybe you're next for the notice of violation, I'm sure that you're going to be able to get some movement and work with the agencies and the industry. So I just wanted to say, the numbers are bad and that type of thing. But overall, we're working and asserting our rights to make sure that the community is protected.
That's great, Sherilyn. Yes, our own environmental regulation, I was happy to hear that's still being worked on. And in fact, we had Navajo Nation attend last year. And so maybe there's some connections there that Sarah could help out with, and or Rhonda, sorry. Rhonda Gagnon, if you can make those connections, that would be great. They did speak to their Environmental Protection Act that they had developed. So perhaps a friendship can be struck there and can look at their environmental process, regulation process. So me, Gretch, I just really wanted to thank everybody. And, it's been a great couple of days, and look forward to learning more. Igwetch
had a comment. It just disappeared on me. Where'd it go? From Stacy Phillips. And Stacy just had a comment about, this being an eye-opening presentation on the feds and province. And it's a prime example of them failing not only the rights of the Anishinaabeg people, but also Ontarians and Canadians as a whole. As a past Lands and Resources Forum, everything is connected, speaks to the notion that the environment should be a priority, as everything depends on land, air, and water. So, Stacy, thank you for that comment. And thank you, Scott and Sherilyn, for your presentation. Appreciate it. And Miigwech, we're going to now move to the Anishinaabeg Nation Caucus. Here's how it's going to happen. For all those who would like to participate in the caucus, there's a couple of things that's going to happen. I'm going to stop the live stream on YouTube. You'll see a recording feature still happening, but that's simply for the Land and Resources Department for their viewing and nobody else's. I'm going to promote attendees that would like to attend and be part of the caucus. I'm going to promote them to panelists, so we'll be able to use their microphones and cameras at this time. For those that aren't staying, Miigwech, thank you for being part of the Land and Resources Forum and Economic Forum. Look forward to connecting with you again. So on that note, as I do that, I'm just going to stop the live stream on YouTube. And now I'd like to,
at this time, for those that aren't staying,
There we go. Had a little feedback there. And I'd also like to hand it over to Jason Laurent. Jason is the lead over at the Land and Resources Forum. But not only that, we've seen and witnessed over the last little while, Jason and his growth as he's sold his motorbike after all these years. And with those proceeds, he bought some land in Temagami. So I think, you know, watching Jason grow and evolve and selling his motorbike, that's a big deal. But excited that he gets to spend it with his family. So I'm going to hand it over to Jason at this time. And let him take it from here. Jason, off you go. And I'll